I put a four-piece together. And people wanted to sign us as a four-piece, which was myself, Steve Katz, Jim Fielder, and Bobby Colombi. And we played those songs without the horns. Because I had a record deal if I wanted it. I wasn't ready for it yet, though. So I put an ad in the paper and started auditioning horn players. And we got some weird people, boy. I mean, because there were no horn players in rock and roll. This was a first. And so we got school teachers, jazz musicians, junkies, washed-up horn players, guys who couldn't play at all. What we did is we had the rhythm section set up, and I had already written the horn arrangements. And so we'd bring in four of them, sit them down, and the rule of thumb was anyone who could play the arrangement and then still wanted to be in the band had the job. Because the arrangements were written real tough to find out, A, who could read, and B, who had the chops to play the arrangements. And that's how we got the band, because there weren't that many people that could do either of those things. I remember this one guy named John Scazzella, who came in. He played the chart real well. He said, "So, you know, what's the money like?" I said, "There is none." He said, "You know, we're just taking a shot here." I said, "Nah, lucked out." Well, while we were auditioning, we went in the studio and I rented two trumpet players, studio guys, and we cut two demos. Three. We cut I Can't Quit Her, My Days Are Numbered, and a song called I Need to Fly, which I wrote with Tony Powers, but didn't make it to the album. So, we had a deal with CBS. Clive Davis signed us. But we didn't have a band. So we would put it, and he knew this, I mean, he knew what he was buying, based on the demos. And so we signed with CBS, and John Simon had produced Simon and Garfunkel. That's where I met him. And he was a pretty good friend at that time. And we, so when he was recording Simon and Garfunkel, I played him I Can't Quit Her and another one that I had written in that series of songs. And he said, "If you ever record those, I'd like to produce them." I said, "Great." And that was before there was a concept of a band. I'd just written the songs. And so when it came time to get a producer, I said, "Let's get John Simon." And it was a good choice. He was the perfect producer for that record. More than enough to last. He went in and took our live show and put it on tape. We went in the CBS studios and cut a pre-production tape. We just went and played all the songs live. And then he would make comments about it and correct it and hone it down. And then we'd rehearse and do his corrections. And then eventually we went in the studio. And the record took 2 weeks from the playing of the first note to the end of the first mix, end of the last mix. We rehearsed for 2 months. And we had played for 2 months. The songs were those songs that I'd written in the Blues Project primarily, coupled with covers of songs that I felt were obscure that needed to be heard. So the covers were So Much Love, a Goffin King song. And let's see, Without Her was my favorite record at the time. It was a 45 Nielsen single. And he did it very Eleanor Rigby-ish, and I turned it into a bossa nova. I just liked the song. I thought it was a great lyric. She'll be there, but she never comes, and I'll wake up and wipe the sleep. Just One Smile was a song that I had worked on with Gene Pitney when I was playing on sessions. I always liked it, a Randy Newman song. This is before anyone knew who Randy Newman was. Including me, no, I knew Randy. Maybe, and Morning Glory was a Tim Buckley song. We wanted to have a couple songs for Steve. So I picked that for Steve and showed it to him. And then he wrote one. And I think all the rest were original. I wanted an overture and an underture. So he did that. Then the thought of having the laughter, I don't know who thought of that, but I agreed with it. So people wouldn't think we were taking ourselves too seriously. I was just trying to get it to sound as good as it could sound.